we start with opening, we open with public comment, and I know you've had a chance to.
Yeah, well, I've said my piece, and it'd be passed on, thank you.
Fantastic, thank you, thanks for participating. Do we have a minute taker for this evening?
May I take the minutes?
Would you be so kind with her? Thank you.
Yes, please.
Thank you.
That's a really good way to model.
Yeah.
Enthusiastic.
Should we keep track of who has and who hasn't, or should we just trust? I see Christine saying.
I think it's helpful to people to know the order, so that we can repeat it again, so I know I'm anxious to have my turn again.
Yeah, and I've been conveniently quiet, because I'm really bad at it, but I would give it a shot.
Okay.
But it would be very, very not good.
I'm bad at washing the dishes, but I do it.
Yeah, there you go, well, you know, but I'm letting you know now that next time, I'll be happy to give it a shot.
Thank you, Joel, and we are so glad to be able to provide you an opportunity to stretch your skills.
Yeah, okay, well, as long as you know the results.
I will, I'll go back and figure out the order we've had so far so that people can make some sense of where they are, so we don't have to spend a lot of time in meetings doing it. Lori, you took these last set of minutes.
I did.
Thank you very much. Any comments, corrections people would suggest before we vote to approve them? Do we have a motion to approve the minutes?
I second the motion.
Okay. All in favor? Any abstention? Any no? Any abstention?
So just procedurally, do you then send them to whoever puts them on our website?
Yes.
Do you do that once they're approved by us?
Yes. Yeah. Okay. We have our mission statement in on Tyvek instead of on paper, because it'll last a little bit longer that way. So
it's so pretty like that.
Yeah, I know, it's beautiful.
So as requested, I just put these up before our meeting so we can be reminded of who we are and what we're here for and the strategies we can employ to meet our mission. And I was really hoping that Brian and Carla were going to be here so we could have a little bit of time to share with them and have them have a little time to be with those, but we'll have to wait for the next meeting, I guess. Let me give you an update on, does anybody want to spend any more time with the mission and strategies at the moment?
I just think that's really great.
Thanks. Okay, I'll give you an update on our Pride Parade, our Pride March t-shirts. The design is really lovely, and a friend of Carla's designed it, and she sent it to me. I sent the order in. The t-shirts are about $20 each. Some of you have already reimbursed me. The rest of you will catch up with me. Those of you who did not tell me your t-shirt size, I made my best guess. So, there's that. Please don't read anything into my best guessing. I had your comfort in mind. But they will be.
Well, we all know what that means.
They will be arriving at my house on Friday, this Friday.
As we say, in the nick of time?
Yes. Yes. Expedited shipping, thank you.
So, we should come by and pick them up?
So, yeah, what would be the best?
When is the march?
Saturday.
Is it
Saturday
this?
In May.
Yep. So it's next week. It's a week from Saturday.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Okay. So we've got a little time.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
So.
Do you have a porch that you could put them on?
I do. I live close to downtown. I'm also happy to deliver when I'm out and about. So maybe after the meeting, you folks come on.
Do you get all the way to Leeds?
It's biking weather now. That would give me a really good reason to bike right up to Leeds.
I would say keep you.
Oh, I'd be happy. And we have, those of you who weren't at the meeting where we talked about it, we understand that some of you are marching with other contingents, so we won't be all marching together. If you're not marching with another contingent, we invite you to join the Northampton elected officials and city worker people. Right?
We also talked about having a collective photo at the beginning or something. I think that would be kind of nice.
Don't look for me. I won't be here. I have a training all weekend, so I'm not dodging you. I'm really not there.
We'll make a cardboard.
Yeah.
I may, in fact, send one of my children in my T-shirt.
Nice.
An imposter.
Does the T-shirt have a slogan?
It has an image with a variety of people, tall, short, you know, different varieties of people. And underneath it says Northampton Human Rights Commission.
Great.
Nice.
Yeah. Simple, and it's a kind of a natural beige off-white color. Mm-hmm. Instead of stark white.
Nice.
Looks like, from what I could see online, it looks like they're a nice quality T-shirt. And the design, I think, is lovely. So.
Thank you for doing that.
Yeah.
Thank Carla. I'm going to pass this around, a thank you note that we can give to the person who designed the design for us.
Correct.
Because that was someone who obviously has those skills. That's why I was hoping Carla would be here.
Yeah.
Someone who I assume is used to being paid for her work and is doing this for us, so.
That's nice, thanks.
So far we're ahead of schedule.
Can you give us an update maybe on our new member?
What I know about our new member is that her name is
Mohammed.
Mohammed. And she has been approved by the City Council. Do you have her email address? Okay, did you? Center the agenda for tonight?
Mm-hmm.
No.
Because
okay.
I didn't know if it was kosher yet.
Okay. All
right. Didn't seem like my role.
Yeah, I don't know if she has been sworn in. And I have not heard from her directly, so I will get her email address from you and check her this week.
So will you ask her to get sworn in and come to the next meeting?
Yes.
Okay. Good.
Yes. And I'll send her recent agendas and minutes as well.
Maybe we can invite her to march with us too.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, great idea. Yeah.
She's got a t-shirt.
Or depending on her size, she could borrow my t-shirt.
I ordered one for her. Elisa helped me with that size guessing. Okay. And we won't make her take minutes, at least not right away.
We'll give her one or two.
Right, we'll let her.
And our next Human Rights Committee meeting happens to be May 24th at 5:30 p.m.
Yeah. Okay. Let me ask if everyone has had a chance to read Lori and Joel's civility proclamation. Does anyone need another copy?
I made copies.
You made copies.
Yeah. Does anybody need a copy? Elisa, do you need one?
I have it.
Okay.
I don't want to get us deep into the discussion of the thing itself right away, but maybe you and Joel could just set some background for where this came from and where you're hoping it will go.
Well, I did some research. I sort of did some research to find out if there were such civility campaigns, and there were some, but they were mostly like in places like universities or schools. I didn't really find any that were for a municipality, and then I just went and looked at the Southern Poverty Law Centers. They have a toolkit for fighting hate, I think. Probably not exactly.
Teaching
right.
Tolerance.
Not quite that, but so anyway, I looked at that, and then I just thought the simplest thing seemed to be to have a proclamation that led to a pledge.
Yeah, I mean, I'll write out that, I mean, Lori did 90% of it. she really did a great job. I just, you know, I talked to her a little bit and came up with some, you know, a couple ideas and thoughts. But I personally thought it was a great idea to have the proclamation. I think that's kind of an nice way to go.
And the things that you'll see in bold are things that I put in after getting a little feedback. So that's why that's like that. So rather than change it, I just put the suggested change and then brought it here.
So we will take this up after we hear from Kitty. Welcome, Kitty.
Well,
thank you for joining us.
I'm happy to be here.
So Kitty Callahan is going to ask us, and some of you were on the commission last year when she spoke to you about the living wage campaign. Is that correct?
I think Lori was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And part of what was decided last year was that the Human Rights Commission would agree to review the living wage campaign and how the cost of living has changed in the year.
Right.
And make another recommendation to the City Council, am I correct?
Yes, okay. That's right, yeah. Right. So, Living Wage Western Mass, which at one time was called the Northampton Living Wage Coalition, we started a number of years ago a living wage campaign here in Northampton, and that was started by a resolution that was unanimously passed by the Northampton City Council, and in that resolution it set forth a process for annually changing the living wage so it wouldn't stay the same amount like the minimum wage has done many times. And so that it's based on changes in the average annual consumer price index change. And so that comes out in January. And we put in the resolution with permission of this organization, the Human Rights Commission, that we would ask them to make the request to City Council every year once we had the figures. To set the change in the rate. So that happened every year except for last year, because last year the rate was so low that it would only go up by 1 cent. So this year the rate went up by 1.3%, and It gave us, based on what the living wage was last year, it gave us a 15 cent increase, but we defer the 1 cent to this year. So it's going up to $13.36 this year. So I sent around, to Karen, is it Karen or Ren?
Karen. Karen is fine.
Oh, Karen, okay. I sent to Karen the information, and did you circulate to everybody?
I did not get it in time to send it out to everyone. There is a lengthy document that from what government organization?
It's the Bureau of Labor Statistics that puts this out.
Right.
And so there's also a chart that I have, two of them that people can take a look at.
I also have a couple copies. I had a,
yeah. And here's another one. No, there's two. Yeah. There's, yeah. So.
Could you say again what the rate that the living wage that you were proposing for this year?
It's $13.36. Are you taking the minutes?
Mm-hmm.
Very good. And so then, once it's approved here, it would be announced by the City Council at their next meeting.
And they would approve it. They would take it up.
Yeah, they
vote on it.
They announce. I go and announce it at that meeting, basically.
Do they vote on it?
No.
Oh,
I see. It's just an announcement.
Any questions for Kitty about these materials?
Just want to clarify, this is participating businesses. and it's a suggested, they sign on and it's a suggested?
Well, yeah, I can, so we have businesses, we have two categories of businesses, and we do, and we certify them. So one category is the businesses who are paying a living wage to every single employee, except for, there are some exemptions. We haven't seen too many of those exemptions applied.
Yeah.
And then the second category is that some employers right now are not at the point where they can pay a living wage. And so gradually, those are called our aspiring employers, and each year they make progress towards paying a living wage.
What would be an exemption?
There is an exemption for people who are in an apprenticeship. There's an exemption for people under the age of 18, workers under the age of 18, unless they're working 35 hours a week.
So like a high school part-time?
Yeah, high school student, yeah. So those are some of them.
Do you mind reminding me, what is the minimum wage now, the federal minimum wage?
It's $11 an hour. And there's also legislation that's been filed to bring it up to $15 an hour, and that would take place in by 2021. In stages, which we will be supporting.
That's the federal minimum wage.
That would be
the
state minimum wage.
Okay.
Yeah, the federal minimum wage is $7.25 an hour, believe it or not.
So, I'm sorry because I wasn't at the thing. What is it you're asking the commission to do, or are you?
I am asking that you agree that we can raise it to $13.36 an hour, based
okay.
on the 1.3% increase.
Okay. So then as a commission, we agree to that or encourage or whatever, and then it gets presented to the city council?
Right, and then
from
Karen,
us?
Karen would send an email to the, I can help you with that
okay.
a little bit. Send an email to the city council, to the president of the city council requesting the change.
Okay, thank you.
That it be put on the agenda for the next city council meeting in the city council meeting the third week of May.
And may I ask, did this begin January 1st? It's a calendar year or is this a fiscal year?
It doesn't begin until it's not supposed to begin until it's approved by the city council. But we're using data that comes out around the 15th of the month of January, because they're compiling the data from the whole year. They have to get the December.
So $13.36 an hour would have been your suggestion as of January 15th, 2017.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
So if they agree
Thank
to it,
you.
They encourage it. They. Are these participating members will be encouraged to immediately do that or as quick as they can?
Well, we notify them of the change and we send out the paperwork, and sometimes it takes some time to get it back.
Okay.
But at least they do, you know, if they do it, that's a good thing.
Right.
Can you share some kind of background information about how the organization makes this known publicly? Do you try and encourage businesses on a regular basis? Are you going around, you know, to individual businesses explaining to them what this is? Just kind of
right.
that kind
so
of
what we so we are our organization has a steering committee, and so it's a volunteer steering committee, and we're all busy people. And so what we do is we send out a mailing to businesses who we think are likely candidates, and then we follow up with phone calls. And it's hard to get people to make phone calls. And we just had a fundraiser for that purpose of hiring a part-time person to, you know, to play that role. Not that we would stop making phone calls, but that's how we encourage employers. You know, we get in touch with employers, explain there's so many benefits for them, for their job, for the entire community. We explain all of that to them. And you know, try to encourage them to sign on. You know, some say that I'm already paying a living wage, but I don't want to get involved. It's really up to the employer whether they're going to do it. We don't twist arms. But we have in Northampton, we have 51 employers that are involved in the program. In Western Mass, we have 20. No, it's 21, I think. 21 employers, so.
That's outside of Northampton?
Yes, that's, and right, we have not certified Amherst because their housing costs are higher than Northampton. And so we're in the process of doing that. I've obtained some data from UMass off campus housing. And Western Mass has a lower rate because the rents are lower outside of Northampton. And that's going to go up to $12.34 an hour this year.
What's considered Western Mass?
Everything except for Northampton and Amherst in the four counties.
Okay, the four counties.
Yes. Yeah. We actually, the most, in those areas, believe it or not, Pittsfield has the most certified employees. So.
Does the town of Northampton pay this minimum wage?
They are an aspiring employer making progress.
Just curious.
Yeah, that's a fair question. Yeah.
I'm asking Alyssa. So if the city council, I assume it's, all of this is guidance or recommendations for, which is why I think it belongs within this committee, because it is sort of I would view it as a human right to receive fair wage. But if the city council says, yes, we agree that this should be the target minimum wage that we're all shooting for, does that carry any weight with the city in terms of budgeting?
Well, it's not a minimum wage, it's a living wage, which is a little bit different, but I think that's partly why the municipality is trying to, they're an aspiring employer, because of that sense that, you know, the city should be in line with something that its council is supporting for, commercial business, so
I'm surprised they're not. What's the reasoning for, is it just?
Budget.
Really? Because yeah. I mean,
and lots
it
of,
is
there's
kind
lots
of
employees as well, so it's.
But it is
yeah.
kind of,
yeah.
I know you don't want to, we're hypocritical, but
Well,
we're not doing it, but we want you to.
There's a distinction between a government body and a commercial enterprise.
I guess, I don't know.
Yeah.
It just seems to me if.
Well, we actually don't create those distinctions, but I think, you know, when you have an employer that has over 1,000 employees and they were paying wages one way, it takes a while to kind of make that adjustment in terms of getting them up to a different standard. Because a living wage, you know, is higher than a lot of employers had been paying. And you know, there's also a lot of constraints on the city budget, but they definitely are making strides in terms of getting towards the living wage. There's a lot of employees who are getting at least a living wage.
Has anybody done the numbers to see what it would cost to make it happen?
No, nobody has done that. Yeah.
So I think that
maybe
there,
they have, but
there
I haven't
town done hall meetings going on now about the budget, and I'm sort of curious if this comes up within those. I think it's happening in Leeds tonight.
Tonight in Florence and tomorrow
yeah.
in Leeds.
Yeah.
So, like all the high school students that work for the rec department, they are exemptions, right?
Under
probably.
So.
Yeah.
So the people.
Unless they're working 35 hours a week or more, and then they should be
right.
exemption.
Right.
Okay.
But plus, if they're 18 or over, then they're not. Then they're entitled to a living wage.
Uh-huh.
Katie, I'm wondering about the public relations of this all, partly because, you know, we passed a wage theft
right.
Order in city council, and one of the immediate reactions we had from many employers in the city was, you know, why do you have to do this? It paints us with a brush, like we're all, you know, stealing wages from people. So I'm wondering if the coalition has ever experienced something similar where people feel like, you know, why should I have to pay that? Or, you know, because I'm not paying it doesn't mean I'm not doing a good job. Or, I mean, have you dealt with that kind of response at all?
I've had some negative response, but I haven't really actually heard that. But, I mean, I think there is a feeling by some employers that they want to do what they want to do. And they're looking, you know, they have a different approach to paying wages than we're suggesting here. And know, we're not going to go to battle with those employers. What we're trying to do is encourage employers and educate employers about the real benefit. There's a lot of benefits for employers to pay people a living wage, and you know, I actually think it helps their businesses and makes them more profitable. And it's also, it also benefits the city. You've got more money out, you've got more money out there in the city, you know, to pay for, to pay local businesses. And you know, there's also money for infrastructure because you've got people that can pay more taxes, people that are using less of financial assistance, food stamps, other programs, because now they're you know, earning more wages, and that money can, you know, come back in various forms. So
Kim, I'm curious about the calculation for the living wage. Does it take into account in some way health insurance? I know that there can be a vast difference about
We actually start, when we drafted the resolution, we started with a two-tier program that would have given employers who are paying for health care, they would have been given kind of a lower living wage amount. And you know, we spoke with someone from the Chamber of Commerce, and you know, she suggested that that might not make sense. And I called Healthcare for All, and they said, actually, if someone is getting, if an employer is paying for somebody's health care insurance, they may not get as good of a deal as you would get through the Healthcare Connector, because someone who's not getting health care insurance and they don't have the highest, you know, they don't have very high wages, they can get a better subsidy through the Health Connector. So we decided not to go that route.
Okay. Thanks.
Yeah. So I have brochures that, you know, people can take, you know, take and give you a little bit more information about our program.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So would it be too much for us to ask the city how many employees aren't getting a living wage and how much it would cost to bring them up to living wage?
I'd be curious to know.
What would you want to do with that?
I guess if it wasn't very much money, I would want to encourage them to try harder.
Yeah.
And if it was very much money, I'd understand.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's up to you if you want to do that. We do have, when we deal with aspiring employers, we have a confidential process. But that's, you know, if you feel we want to do that.
Well, I mean, the city is not a confidential.
Right. That's right. They do. Yeah. But we can't give out any information. Yeah.
Anyway, how do
other
people?
Yeah,
I agree.
Yeah.
We have to do a motion and all that to even see the first application.
I mean, I guess I assume this should be information they have if they're looking at this issue, and if they don't have it, maybe it's a lot of work, but they should have it.
Yeah, I think that they probably should. And there's also some information on the website, but it's hard from looking at that to tell, like, actually what the hourly rate is. So, but they have the information about everybody's annual salary on there.
When you have the member organizations, those aren't the businesses that are doing it. That's,
right.
They're two separate things, right?
That's correct. Okay. Yeah.
Do you have a list at all of the businesses that are...
Yes, I do.
Is it on the website, or...
I could actually send Karen a copy of it because I announced it. They announced it last week.
Yeah, I'd like to know.
Right. Our unfortunately, our website's not up to date. So.
And Hitty, is there a you? I hear you say you want to do this to present it for the May meeting of the City Council.
Right.
I'm aware that. We all haven't gotten a chance to go through the the documents that you sent me.
Okay.
So I want to ask the commissioners how comfortable you feel voting on this before you have a chance to review.
So the documents we haven't seen, are they about the calculations that were used to determine?
There was the one from the Bureau of Labor Statistics that's like a 40-page document or something. And then there was this chart.
Yeah.
And then there was one other document that you sent me.
Well, the Bureau of Labor Statistics, it's actually, it's actually five pages of that.
Oh.
And if you're gonna look at that, I mean, I think it's a little, the way that they write this report is very confusing, because they talk about, you know, over the last 12 months it rose 2.1%, which is not, if you look at the chart, it gives, I think I gave away my last chart. So this chart. So you want to go to the column that says annual. And if you look at 2016, you see 1.3% when you look at that. So does everybody have the chart that you can see the 1.3%?
Mm-hmm.
But if you look at the document, it's talking about 2.1%, and that's only like the increase in from December 2015, it increased 2.1%. So that, I don't know why they write it that way, but it's very confusing. You know, so you've got to understand that the figure is 1.3%, and they do a lot of that they make that December number look like that's the number, but it's not. It's the 1.3%. So that's the.
I don't feel like I need to study those documents, and I feel like I would be fine to take a vote on this.
I agree.
And my request for more information isn't necessarily to hold up this vote. So if other people want to vote, I'll make a motion.
Just one thing before you make the motion. So what was the living wage last year? This year, 1336. What was last year?
It was 1318. I mean, 1318.
Yeah. Can other communities have this process?
Well, I don't think there's any in Massachusetts. There's three down in North Carolina. There's one in Colorado. New York State has one. So there's some of, you know, there's some of us, and we talk on the telephone occasionally, actually, about, you know, what's going on and what people are doing.
And this is something that you took an interest in and just kind of stood up from scratch.
Well, my congregation, Unitarian Society, decided to do a living wage social justice project, and I said, well, I think I'm interested in that, and here I am many years later. Yeah, so it's been an interesting project, but we really need to get some paid people. Every other organization that that's, you know, on that national network has people that are paid. So that's the.
Thank you so much for doing it all these years as a volunteer.
So can I make a motion?
Yes.
I move that we adopt the living wage as proposed by the Northampton Living Wage at Western Mass, right? Yeah. At 1336, is that what it was?
Yes.
Per hour.
Yeah. I'm sorry.
Can I make a recommendation to the city council?
Oh, and that,
sorry.
Oh, what?
And make a part of the motion, just to make a recommendation to the city council that it be adopted.
Oh, okay. I thought she said it just gets announced to the city council. So you guys vote on it too?
Yes.
It's an announcement. It gets announced at the city council.
So these guys vote on it, and then
it's approved here, and it's announced at the city council.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Stand corrected, sorry.
You're approving to convey the information is really what you're approving.
And sorry. As a member of the Living Wage Western Mass, did because we are, in fact, a member of the organization.
Right. Yeah. And there's also individual members too. We have over 300 individual members, and I can leave with people the form for that. The other one, you just have to live, work, or do business in Northampton. And I mean, some of you I think are already members, but I'll just pass some around.
So the motion that we have is that we, or maybe Booker,
we move that we make a recommendation. We inform the city council that we approve the recommendation for the living wage as presented this evening.
And then should we add to that, and we ask the city for a report back on how many workers are not receiving the living wage for the city?
I don't think you want to put that as part of the.
I could be a.
Part of our endorsement.
Okay.
Yeah, but I do want that.
Yes. Yeah. So it's been moved and seconded, so we can have some discussion about the motion. And I would like to discuss something, but I don't know if anyone else has topics. Okay. So I'm thinking about the strategies that we have at our fingertips to use to magnify our mission. And one of them is to invite participation and also to celebrate victories and progress in the field of human rights. So I wonder if this might also be an opportunity for us to report on the progress that the city is making towards the goal, in which case I'd want to have that information in advance. And also maybe to make public or to in some way honor or celebrate those Northampton businesses that are already certified.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
That's great.
So,
in what ways already do you celebrate these businesses? Is there a symbol in the window, or is there some?
Yeah. So at the last city council meeting, I announced we acknowledged the businesses.
Mm-hmm.
So I read off the list of businesses, and we also last year we started distributing certificates and decals. So an employer who's paying a living wage, they can get, you know, both certificates and decals. We don't give out the decals to the aspiring employers,
right?
Because the certificates have the date, the year on it. So that one, you know, every year they have to, you know,
they
show that they're making progress. So
great.
Do you send out a press release, and is it covered by the newspaper and things like that? Is that because I'm just wondering if that would dovetail with what you're suggesting, Karen, doing something along those lines?
I think we did early on send out a press release, but we haven't done that in a while for that.
Another reference to having a paid staff person, mm-hmm. I believe.
Yes. Yeah.
I think even just this resolution, whatever the word is, is a great press release.
Any additional discussion on the motion?
Just, did you have something in particular in mind, Karen, about celebrating?
I didn't. I had thought naming those businesses that are already certified, but it sounds like he's already done that at one council meeting.
Can you remind me how many there are?
Well, in Northampton, there's 51.
Okay.
Four of those employers are aspiring employers.
That's a tremendous
that's quite
number, I think.
Well, we'd like it to be more, but we'll take whatever we can get. It's exciting to get a new certified employer.
I wonder if it would be too much to write thank you notes to them all. It's 50 thank you notes, but it could be one from the Human Rights Commission thanking them for being living wage.
Could do that as like an op-ed or something, maybe. The one caution is that the more public it becomes, the more there is pushback from those that feel like somehow they're being mischaracterized as stingy or so.
Well, that's why I'm suggesting we send them thank you notes in the mail, like a thank you note, just not putting it in the paper, but sending them a thank you note. They can put it in a frame and put it on their wall if they want to, but just a letter from the Human Rights Commission.
Could we do a letter to the Gazette that only refers to looking at the out-of-date website? I mean, I sort of get that doing something that sort of names organizations becomes a, it could be viewed as advertising in an interesting way. But if it was saying, we want to really celebrate these groups, and by the way, here's how you can find out about them if you went to this website, that might be a good thing.
So we have to get it updated, yeah. Which?
Roll that.
No, that's okay, because I think that will give us an impetus. So, yeah, if we coordinate a little bit on the date, on the timing of this.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that that update could be done by the council meeting in May?
So it's the third week. It's the third week of the month. Yes, I think so.
That's the second one of May, so you want to wait until then, because
have our meetings on the first Thursday. That's why I always come on the third Thursday. That's why, because that we make progress as a result of those meetings.
So it's the 18th.
Yeah.
Okay. So we'll stay in touch.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes. So I'll get you the information to send on to them.
Kitty, thank you for coming
thank
in
you
for
so much.
Jumping right in as soon as you got here. I really appreciate
it. Oh, no, that's no problem. Oh, thank you. You all, thank you for your interest and your attention and approving my request.
Right. I think we are ready to vote, right? And Booker, have you been keeping track of the amended, the friendly amendments as they've been?
I'm not looking at it, but I'll probably try to, well, let's say what the, is the amended proposal also about how did we celebrate those organizations to do it?
Do we want to include that?
Is the proposed, so let me read back. So we move, we recommend that we have approved the recommendations for a new living wage, period. We would also like to celebrate those organizations who have already begun to participate in this, framing something close to the spirit of.
Would you accept the friendly amendment?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
And in the spirit of celebration, I will try to time with Kitty a public letter to the editor in some public way, acknowledging that there have been progress in the state of Northampton in this regard, and that further information can be found on her website. And we'll also send thank you notes on behalf of the commission. And maybe, so that was a wordy question, but
yeah.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Abstentions? Unanimous. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I really feel supported by those suggestions of thanking employers and also doing the op-ed piece. Mm-hmm. And I'm happy to help with that.
Thank you.
Yeah,
we'll
look
I'm
it over.
Calling you for that.
Yeah.
But
well,
we'll
you.
Need the addresses. Yes, at the very least, I'll need their addresses.
Oh, the employer addresses.
Yes.
I'll get, yeah, definitely
yeah,
get
fantastic.
That out. But I'd be happy to help with the op-ed piece, too,
okay.
If you want me to look it over.
It'd be terrific. Thank you. Mm-hmm. And will you thank your colleagues who have been toiling away?
I certainly
thank
will.
You. We notice that it's hard work and it's good work, and thank you.
Thank you.
I wonder if we could use the t-shirt logo as a letterhead or like a card. Mm-hmm.
I don't think we have the same constraints as we would if we had to use the city seal. Awesome. Okay, great. Thank you all. Shifting gear back to the call for civility proclamation. Oh, and I will send you those documents that Kitty sent me. I'm sorry that I tried to print them out and my printer did not cooperate. But I'll let you look at them anyway. So
just the other part is, as you can see from that first paragraph, these are just ideas about how we might want to promote it. But I guess before we get to that part, we should probably talk about the proclamation and the pledge and see what people think and what people want changed. And Karen had, I emailed this to Karen, and I think you had a question about the first one.
I do want to just,
I thought we could either delete it or we could run it by the police chief.
Mm-hmm. Right, my question was, if we are putting it as a whereas, then I just want to be certain that what we're claiming or what we're naming as an assumption is actual.
Yeah,
great. Actually verifiable.
Are we digging into the language? Should we?
If we want to, sure. So unless we want to talk about it in general and then dig into the language.
Yeah, I think it makes sense to start at the general and then move into the specific so we don't get caught in wordsmithing right away.
Oh, that's probably good.
So the idea for this is to have this be a proclamation that is presented to City Council. Am I correct?
Yes.
Okay.
And that. For me, I think we talked about this last time, it's just that I really feel, and the more research I did, I came even more, and I tend to, not in our town meetings up in Greenfield, so I've been thinking about it a lot, that this can't all fall on law enforcement.
Mm-hmm.
So, and also, I mean, just thinking about all these, like, I mean, I don't know if you've seen the New York Times, the Boston Globe, maybe the Post, too, I'm not, there's like, probably a dozen large newspapers that are asking people to send this in, and I kind of feel like it should have a community response, not just, this isn't just like law enforcement's,
mm-hmm.
We shouldn't just dump it in law enforcement's lap. So, that's where I'm coming from.
So, I really liked everything about this. The only thing that there might be a concern about, and this comes back to, it's not just the police responsibility, but the what bold facing further to call out people who do hate speech. And the question is what does that mean? And do people know how to do that?
And I think that's a really good question. And I think it was just a poor choice of words. Because, you know, it was meant to just say, be an ally to somebody. So that's why I suggested that stand behind the targets. But other people might have other ideas. I mean, and I think it's hard to say what it looks like. But the idea is just that that the pledge would be something like, not just that we promise not to do it, but we're gonna help somebody who might be the victim in some way. I don't mean like vigilante, but so.
I had a similar reaction, I think, to that one phrase. So I think framing it more along the lines of what you're saying, Lori, is you know, that we will proactively stand by the person who is targeted or something. So the focus is on that kind of positive action as opposed to, you know, shaming or finger pointing,
exactly.
Which are all things that don't model civility in a different way.
Exactly. It's kind of like what happens happened in Billings, Montana, when, mm-hmm. you know, they all put their menorahs in their windows. That's what they did.
Or in Denmark,
all put the stars on.
Stars.
Can you repeat what you just said, Elisa? Just the wording for that, because it was not quite what I have here. Proactive, and we pledge to refrain from blah blah blah, and proactively.
Stand by
support,
or protect
stand by
or support.
Support and stand by and support.
Okay.
Victims of.
Should we say victims or targets?
I would only say those who are.
Okay, those who are targeted?
That's a better,
okay.
It gets into, I don't know, get into what does it mean to figure out.
Yeah, no, okay, that's good.
Exactly.
So this is what I have. We pledge to refrain from denigrating other people based on who they are, proactively stand by and support those who are targeted.
Does the thesaurus have a more user-friendly word than denigrating? I love the word denigrating personally, but it's a bit cumbersome and a pledge that we're going to be asking high school students. And
demean is one.
And thesaurus.
I was just going to do that. I'll let you do it.
Well, Lori, like
all this. Besmirch, defame, disparage?
Yeah, disparage.
Vilify.
Disparage seems most like what we're trying for.
Calumniate.
Whoa. I think one thing that I'm struggling with in the pledge is that there is, I think, rightly so in the early part, attention to setting a tone of the community. And in the pledge, we're pledging to act individually instead of shaping the community standards or norms. So I wonder what other people think of that.
Well, that was on purpose.
Okay.
And because when I got to it, I thought I didn't want there to be. I feel like this is on the verge of something that could be seen as like thought police or something, right? And so all you can ask people to do is refrain from saying those things. You can't really ask them to change their attitude, mm-hmm. but you can ask them to keep it inside. You know what I mean? So that's why I just decided to have the pledge be simple. But again, that's just my reasoning.
No, and I had agreed with that completely. I think the point is we do not want this to be used as allowing some people to say, this is what you're supposed to be doing. You know, I think that, you know, I think some people could take that to an extreme or take it completely out of context. And so I think it is important to just say, you know, we're not telling you to change what you're thinking or whatever, that's not the point is, but be civil.
I like what Karen's saying, though, like to somehow bring it back. Like, I understand that point, and I don't think it's mutually exclusive of this idea of somehow figuring out a little tweak of the language that brings it back to this idea that, you know, we as a community don't tolerate this. I think that's kind of where you were going with that,
right.
Somehow conveying that.
So it's not just to a civil community by refraining from.
Right.
There you go.
That's
I like
a good
that.
Way to do it.
Yeah, that's a good way of saying it.
So in a, right here, the second sentence where it says, we pledge to, you're suggesting saying, can you repeat that, Karen?
A pledge to contribute to building a civil Northampton by refraining from besmirching, is that what we want to
know? No.
Disparaging?
Disparaging, yeah.
I really like that sentence.
I pledge to commit to building or
To contribute to
okay.
creating a civil Northampton. By refraining from actively
okay.
doing this and being allies.
Okay, got it.
You know, there's like a little grammatical issue with the last sentence there too, right? As a way to neutralize bigotry and support to the targeted individual.
The two should be gone.
So I have some discomfort, and I'm not going to be able to articulate it very well. In the very first part of the pledge, it says, "In which no crime is committed." I feel like when you start talking about acts of hate, whether they're criminal acts or not criminal acts, is kind of irrelevant. And crime is, the concept of a crime or a criminal act is a legalistic one. And I feel like we're talking more in a way that isn't about legalistic yes or no. We're talking about shifting a culture. Mm. And so I don't think it's necessary to even include that in which no crime is committed.
So you could just say bias incidents and acts of hate destroy the fabric.
Yeah,
I think that's a good, really good point.
Takes out the legalese.
Yeah, right.
So after I read this, I went to all these websites trying to decide what is hate speech and what is and what's protected. And it's actually acts that are not protected.
Right.
It's speech is protected. You can say whatever you want as long as it doesn't incite or seems to incite to an act. So I think you're right that just simply saying act sort of gets the legal thing. That is actually the legal issue.
And we're talking about the spirit of something more than we're, you know, trying to parse whether something is legal or isn't legal.
Yeah, you know why I did that, and but I can see that it's not necessary, is because I kept thinking about the gap between what the police do and I was trying to say there are some things that the police can deal with, and these are the things that we can deal with that the police can't.
I think including anything, and that actually brings me back to another comment that I wanted to make about the proclamation, and that is, and it sounds like you're already planning on kind of verifying with the police and this and that, but I feel like something like this, just because I think we should have some sensitivity around the role that the police play in communities of color that is not always civil, and just take that piece out and instead say something like, if we end up using this, whereas Northampton has seen an increase in bias-motivated name-calling, we don't have to say where it comes from, or if you feel like we need to be kind of data-driven, we could say, whereas data collected in Northampton indicates that the city has seen an increase in bias-motivated name-calling. I just, giving the police that, you know, the first whereas role, like the police say that this is, just felt kind of like a bit of a punch in the gut to me, that we don't need.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, that would take care of the whereas, too.
Yeah.
If you took the police out of it. You know, you said whereas Northampton has seen.
Yeah.
You would just do what you say in the bold, which is to delete that first paragraph and start with the second paragraph, which says, whereas there's been an uptick around the country. And because I'm a person who sometimes moves outside of my community, I'm not going to limit my pledge to Northampton. I would take it with me to my other communities that I go in. So,
well, I mean, also, I guess the point of it, it's being, if we leave it out, it's just like, this is a very proactive thing we're doing. Not necessarily because there's this scourge on the streets of Northampton.
Yeah,
just don't want that to happen.
I think we need to have the word Northampton in there. I really do, because with the Northampton Human Rights Commission, and this is for the city of Northampton.
So what if we said we get rid of the first one, and in the second one we say, whereas there has been an uptick in Northampton and around the country.
Because right. That would answer your question too. Mm-hmm. You know.
I think it's important too, because this community is a little bit famous for, you know, people being like, oh, that doesn't happen here. So
right.
I think to
right.
name that
yeah.
is
yes.
kind of important to lead. I mean, if there's concern that it needs to be like evidence-based, you could footnote it and say, see with the website if the police, I don't know if they're posting it or whatever, but could do something like that if it feels like evidence needs to be provided.
Well, that's the point. There, it isn't reflected in the numbers.
Right.
These aren't like crimes, and they only collect crimes. So,
except if they're collecting this, they must somehow. So this is just like off the top of the
head.
What
about the Attorney General's office would have some.
Oh, so that could be the other, if we want to footnote it.
That is a, I don't want anybody to look at this and say prove it or you say so or something
right.
like that. So when you say there has been an uptick, somebody's gonna go, well, according to who? Says who? So if we do have some sort of a statistic show, even if we say that, that we're...
Well, we can't say statistic show.
Yeah.
We don't have that. But, so, I mean, the uptick is shown in the other things that are on here. You know, the fact that these papers are collecting it. I mean, the police chief told us she's heard reports. But it's, but because it's not a crime, they're not logging those reports.
Right.
Okay. So is there a way that the police chief...
I'm sorry?
Is there a way our captain, chief of police, can tell us whether there is more, my guess is she has more reports of hate speech, but she cannot give, but that's not a reportable statistic.
It's anecdotal.
So, but would she go on record as saying there is an increase in hate speech? I would prefer not to have a proclamation because we're concerned that the rest of the country seems to be having a problem. I agree that it's a problem here too. And it would be nice if we can say in what way we recognize that it's a problem here too. And that's why I'm looking for a way that...
Well, but do you feel like, would it be if we said an uptick in Northampton and around the country, would that do it for you?
I agree that there ought to be someone other than our own sense of what there's an uptick in Northampton.
Well, but that's sort of the point. Like there are the things the police take care of. And then there are things that are kind of equally unacceptable that the police don't take care of.
Well, at least they take care of, but they don't keep statistics on.
Well, they don't take care of them. I mean, if it's not a crime, they're not going to do anything about it.
You're talking about what Elise referred to previously, which is the tone or culture of our community. And I think it's a great piece of work, but I think it's sort of sweeping to bring in the New York Times and the Boston Globe and the country. If we're talking about, I think it's a big bite. And if we keep going back to saying we want to focus on Northampton and the fact is this is happening in our community, then I would almost prefer to talk about our community and not the country, but what's happening in my community. Think locally, think globally, act locally. What's happening here?
Well, right, but if you look at that, I'm sorry, but if you look at that sentence, I think the only point of the New York Times and Boston Globe, the only reason that's being brought up is because other media outlets around the country have responded to the subject by inviting people to report such incidents.
Well, I mean, I feel like it's the context. It's right. The context that this city is living in.
So Julie Casper was concerned about was sort of episodes of seeing people being taunted. But it still was in the hate, it was hate speech, but not actionable because it wasn't illegal. But they don't actually keep statistics of that. It's not written in a ledger someplace that this many things have happened. That's sort of this
yes.
data problem. Right.
The fact is we're writing a proclamation based on anecdotal
yeah.
evidence,
yeah.
not empirical data,
yeah, yeah.
And we can own that. Because people have brought their stories to this commission, including mm-hmm. Commissioner Velez, who brought her own stories. And I reported also anecdotal evidence, from someone in our community who's a restaurant owner who preferred not to be named in any identifying way. So I think that we can say that this is what we do. I mean, Karen, you're famous for this. How do we work this out of our strategies or what we're doing? But we are hearing mm-hmm. things are being brought to the Human Rights Commission, and we've noticed, and
that's
we
good.
we don't need empirical data. We've noticed this. This didn't happen last year or the year before this presidential election. It wasn't brought to our attention. So it's been brought to our attention by stories. And why are those stories not valuable? Why do we need empirical data.
Yeah, and I guess if we're talking about climate and culture, that also is something that isn't necessarily numbers.
And if we want to be proactive, we can change some of this speech from, I don't want this, 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 and this, but forward thinking and sort of turn our speech around and say, the ways that we do, are some of these other, were there other examples that were I pledged to, I mean, I understand being a vice, you know, these are sort of a reaction to something that we
yeah.
see.
The ones I read were kind of like, it was like a lot about, you know, it was like at academic institutions, so it was sort of, in, you know, intellectual, like respecting other people's ideas and that kind of thing. And again, I don't think that's what we're talking about here. We're talking about like, it's not right to go down the street and call, tell someone to go back where they came from. That's just not okay.
Respected.
I mean, I'm not saying there shouldn't be even vehement disagreements about politics. Just, it's just that there's like a basic human decency thing. So that's why I didn't go with any of the ones from the colleges, because they were just a little too.
The college, I read a lot of the ACLU and the, they're all getting concerned about not having all speech be done. So there's a little bit of a pendulum swing
right.
on at the moment. So, well, I guess we can simply, maybe we can say the Human Rights Commission is hearing, by the way, I'm chafing at the idea that there were no human rights, there were no hate speech going on before last November.
I'm
totally chafing at that. And that's why it, I think there was, but.
Yeah,
of course.
No.
For,
yeah,
so.
There definitely was.
Okay, you get to say we suddenly noticed.
Fair enough.
Well, I think we're kind of going around circles then, because I think what we're all saying is that you can basically, we're okay with saying, whereas there has been an uptick. Except I would just add around in Northampton and around the country, I'd add that. But I think, you know, to your point, we don't need to, I've come full circle now. I agree, we don't need to.
I've let go of that too.
Category, you know, sit there and say statistically.
So Elisa, I have a question then. You had, so if we make this second whereas the first whereas, do you think we should get rid of the part of that that says, as well as actions that qualify as criminal acts? So just say.
I will with that.
Okay.
Because I think what you're trying to do there is lead into the rest of it that talks about respect for freedom of speech. And so I understand why that would be there more,
right.
but.
Yeah. Right.
I think talking about criminal acts is kind of
Do you still think we should? I mean, I guess I felt like it was important here to really say, look, we believe in free speech.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Okay.
But there's one other line in there that I think we got to be careful with, and that's about the on a fifth or sixth, where it says, "In the with every single one of us, by committing to respecting each other and calling out hate slurs when we witness."
How about rejecting?
Yeah, I mean the calling out.
Yeah.
I have a little bit of a concern with that because I don't want people to think they can walk around and stand up there and publicly
yeah.
call somebody out.
Right. So what's a better way to say that? So
you can just say
say naming.
Naming. Okay. Naming. That's good. Naming hate slurs when we witness them?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I don't understand what naming at all.
So the idea is, it's not just that this is, it's not just that we're saying we won't do this. It's also like, if somebody does it, I'm not gonna just like pretend I didn't see
okay,
it.
Okay, I got it. All right, now it makes sense. All right.
See, this is what we were talking about in the pledge, that there's actually a lot of training that goes on mm-hmm. with, well, what do you do when you're there, when something happens? Do you, and that's where the, I think, so
the role of the bystander.
What's the role of the bystander? And it's a may be a dangerous thing to say. I don't think you understand how painful you're being.
No.
But another, which would, that would be calling out. That, I mean, pardon me, that would be naming.
Right, right.
Or, ouch, that sounds really hard to hear. That's a little different. There are all these different techniques, but I don't think we're going to be able to train that. That's why I'm more comfortable with supporting, finding a way to support the person that's being
targeted.
Maybe people are comfortable with saying, doing some of these naming things or calling the police because it feels uncomfortable or something else,
it is a different kind of intervention.
They're all different kinds of interventions.
Well, that's worth saying, that there are different types of intervention. There now exists a Massachusetts hotline. There are trainings that you can go to. You can Google how to support someone who's the victim of hate speech. You know, how helpful do we want to be?
I think that's a really good point, and I wonder if we want to get more concrete maybe create a third document, which is a resource document, like watch this video online, do this, call blah, blah, blah for more information, call the AG's hotline, because otherwise it is just kind of all theoretical.
Well, we are doing this tonight too, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so they could go together.
It's 6:45.
Well, so can I just go back to... back to this, the fifth whereas, after we cross off the first one, committing to respecting each other, and instead of naming hate slurs, you do think we should do what we did with the pledge, which is to say, and supporting the target of a hate slur when we witness it?
Oh, okay. I like that.
The person who was targeted, so...
Right. Okay.
Yeah,
I think this will lead to, maybe we will need to say we should suggest here resources for learning how to do this.
That may be an educational event that this commission does, which is to hold a training or a learning or some way in which we...
I get what you're saying, Booker, about their strategies and techniques and stuff, but supporting the person who's targeted seems like common sense. And so... that's the least we can do.
You'd be surprised how many people don't do it, though. Pretend like they don't.
But I mean, I'm saying is, I don't think you need a training to, like, if someone's had something like that happen, say, I'm so sorry that happened.
I think that Booker's point might be that it's sometimes awkward or uncomfortable, and you are putting, you're the bystander, and you are then suddenly opening yourself up to also being targeted.
No, I don't think we're disagreeing.
Yeah,
we're not disagreeing.
We're all saying the same thing.
It's just how you the perspective. We're looking at the person who's targeted rather than that. We're not going to be the thought police for the person who said the thing, but we can, you know.
I want to thank Lori 90% and Joel.
Well, I mean, you know, it's true. She did most of the work. I throw in my 2 cents and all, but...
Well, is it 2 cents or 10%?
Well, I'll leave that up to her.
That's what 10% is worth these days.
In seriousness, I want to thank you for taking this vague idea that we had last month and creating a shape to it. And giving us a sense of what's possible. So thank you both for being willing to do that and for doing it. I feel that there's not an urgency to this, that we have to have this decided upon tonight. And it's occurring to me as I'm sitting here that when we talk about upticks, there also tends to be an uptick in the summer months when the heat goes up, when the temperature goes up, the tempers flare as well. So I wonder if maybe it might be something to think about launching this as the summer approaches, in coordination with, I see you've put NHS in here, the high school.
encouraging students to sign on to how they will behave outside of school and when they're in the community more in the summer? Does it make sense to not try and push this completely forward?
Yeah, well, I think at the very least I should revise this based on all this feedback and bring it back to the next meeting.
But I think,
hopefully there'll be more people here too.
I think in answer to that, though, we would need to have something done by the next meeting if you want to get to the kids.
Right, yeah.
Because by the meeting after that, they're done.
Right.
So.
Okay. So is there a subcommittee that would like to work on a more, on the next generation of this proposal for the next meeting?
I'll do 10 if you'll do 90.
Well, no.
Look, at least I'm honest.
Well, I am happy to revise this based on what everybody said. And I don't want to take on the job of resource, like a resource thing. If anybody else wants to do that, because I heard at this meeting that people think that would be a nice thing to go with this. So somebody else could do that.
We also don't have to recreate the wheel of that, because I know like the Pioneer Valley Workers Center, AFSC, some of the churches, Andrea Vazian just launched her Sojourner Truth School, and she may have those resources too, so there are ways to do it without a lot of effort.
Right. I mean, is it okay with Karen if I just do this and bring it back?
Yes, and I will carry...
I mean, unless you think that some this top paragraph should be fleshed out more, but.
I mean, if you could do it and then email it so that we have time to read it before the next.
Oh, that I can do, yeah.
Yeah, I think that would be great.
Yeah, and I just, does anybody feel called to come up with an idea or a vision of what to do with once we have the words that Rory will bring to us next month?
I think that will be a vigorous discussion at the next meeting, because our new members will be here also.
So
but one thing is
this what you're asking, for instance, who should be taking the pledge? Should the
how to disseminate it?
Should the city council take the pledge? Should the high school take the pledge? Should the middle school take the pledge?
How to get the word out
too? Do you take it to churches and say, would you like to suggest that churches and temple
right,
temples
yeah.
where do you want to take this pledge?
Right.
I agree with postponing the discussion because I think it'll be a rich discussion.
I say vigorous, you say rich.
It could be both.
Yeah. I don't know. It's not singing.
We're just celebrating.
Awesome. Okay. And briefly, in a new business, I did send a copy of this meme or.
Did you make this? I thought you did. I love it.
Okay.
I'm so impressed with you.
There's
yeah,
so many Googleable things out there. Google meme making. So this is something that we could ask the city to put on the Northampton Facebook page to let folks know that it's a resource that's out there.
Could the Gazette run it like every week in a little box?
They could.
Ask them to do it for free.
Getting smaller and smaller.
Right, so do we, I guess the question I have is...
The police department already has it on their website. Not your meeting.
Right,
but.
Yes, they have it on their website. Do we want to hold on to this till we get the proclamation, or do we want to go just put it out there in the world, or just not at all?
I mean, I think it goes really well with the proclamation.
It's like a whole campaign.
Yeah, true. I mean, I think we should hold it until we have that, and then this could very well be used in coordination with that.
It might be that simple. If I have a list of 10 places to report a crime or where
exactly.
to go to training or something, I think a hotline number is really helpful.
So do you know if we have the ability to like put something like this on? Do we have our own page?
We do not have our own page, but Alyssa will put on whatever the commission has.
Not me.
But, not
me.
Yeah,
no,
I just because you're not Alyssa, you're Alyssa.
That's correct.
We're meeting at 7:07.
Oh,
yeah.
There you go.
Okay. We have six more minutes, Sarah.
I guess this place where there's the minutes and the agendas. can we have this on that? And she can do that for us?
Yeah.
So I wonder if she can, if there's an interactive ability to have, if we did have the pledge there, people go there and sign it. Mm-hmm. So anyway, that's my curious question.
I can look this up on my own if need be, but so if a phone call is made, what happens?
I know, because I was at a meeting where they discussed it. People from the Attorney General's office will investigate it. They'll get back in touch with you and, yeah.
My brother answers that hotline sometimes. He works at the AG's office. They take shifts.
And they're trying to get the data that what we're talking about.
Yeah.
They also listen to people's stories, which I think is not as
good. Right, that's true.
So, and so what they would certainly have is how many phone calls have they gotten.
Yes. And I think I did ask the question, are you dividing it up by community? And I think they said they would be. But I don't know how, whether it's real time that you can get that data. Because it just started, you know, not that long ago. So we won't be able to compare it to anything.
Yeah. And since they're just starting, they can't talk about 2 years ago.
Right.
When I understand there were some things going on.
Yes. All right, Booker, thank you very much for taking our minutes.
You'll decide that later.
Yes.
I know that I'm already grateful.
I have new business.
You have new business.
We'll take half a second. I just want to say, like, having come to these meetings for like 2 years now, this is like so amazing. You guys are amazing and doing such good work. Karen has like helmed this so beautifully. It's just a pleasure sitting here in these meetings when it wasn't always.
I second that wholeheartedly.
That's all. I just want to say that.
Thank you all. I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
Okay.
Second.
Are you sure?